Spike Lee says it is crazy to expect him to have a solution to racism and do the right thing.
I never said I was Jesus Christ.
An Olympic champion, Jackie Joyner Kersee, says winning isn't everything, but she loves the feeling. Tonight on Visions. Hundreds of babies born to drug-addicted mothers are being abandoned in hospitals all across the United States. Many are forced to live for months or even years as border babies in hospital wards until someone can be found to take them home. Across the country, 15 of the 18 hospitals surveyed by a congressional committee reported births of drug-exposed babies had at least tripled since 1985. Here at Hahnemann Hospital in Philadelphia, the situation is critical. And social worker Judy Wattman told Visions it gets worse every day.
I would say probably in the intensive care nursery, there are probably at least 50 to 60% of those babies have been exposed to drugs. Not all of them will be abandoned nor ignored. And there are probably a few on the pediatric unit and OB unit that have been exposed to drugs. We get an awful lot of babies that come from full-term pregnancies that have been exposed to drugs, and sometimes they are abandoned, sometimes they are not. Sometimes those children go home to horrible situations that we can really have no control over.
Wattman says babies of drug-using mothers are frequently born too soon and too small. They often need intensive care because of respiratory problems or liver failure. Many must be carefully nursed through withdrawal from their drug addictions.
It is amazing to me that a woman will use as much cocaine as she does during pregnancy and have a baby come out full term and relatively healthy. Because what we know from research is that when somebody gets high for, say, 20 minutes, the baby in utero stays high for 4 solid days.
Not every baby born to a cocaine-using mother suffers this way, but those who do face enormous torment. They're irritable, have trouble sleeping, feed poorly because they can't suck properly, and though they want to be cuddled, many cannot stand to be touched. No one comes to visit them. For many, the only hope is finding foster care.
In any given day, there may be as many as 30 children who need homes, who are in hospitals or in emergency foster homes who need placement.
Portia Scholl is the director of the Philadelphia Medical Foster Care Consortium. She's working with these representatives of local nonprofit child welfare agencies to recruit foster parents for the city's special children.
She's married and she has 2 other children.
I have children who are born premature, whose lungs are not developed, whose heart is not working properly or normally, whose stomach doesn't work normally, so you have children that need oxygen, you have children who need to be on a heart monitor, you have children that need tube feedings and things of that nature.
There's no question that it is an ordeal for the babies, but it can also be a tremendous challenge for the person who offers foster care.
We ask the foster parents to go through what we call a foster parent orientation, in which we describe the program. And I think it's important for the foster parents to know that these agencies are subcontracted through the city, through the Department of Human Services, Division of Children and Youth, and that we have to follow regulations. City regulations and state regulations.
It's not an easy road. You do have to go through a home study. You do have to go through an orientation where you learn all about your certifying agency.
Linda Carter is a recruitment specialist with the consortium.
You do have to go through a police check and a child abuse check. And this not only holds for the woman that calls, which is usually the person that calls, but it goes for the husband, whoever is living in the household. So it's quite a strenuous ordeal, and a lot of people are weeded out during that process.
Carter says it is sometimes hard to convince people to go through the rigorous checking and training demanded by the regulations. But when she succeeds, as in the case of Anita Jackson of Mount Airy, the results are rewarding.
I figure I'm 42 years old. I've seen the larger part of my life. and I'm going to take these last years and do for others.
Terrence, the foster child placed with Anita and her family last February, has a colostomy and needs constant attention. But it's obvious he's getting plenty of love and everything else he needs to thrive in this home.
This child might be in a foster home from the age of 3 months and until 13, 14 years old. I've seen children that have just gone from one home to another home to another home to another home. So how could you turn your back on a child?
We have some amazing foster parents that will take all types of children, okay, and we'll come back and say, well, we did good with this child with the trach, we'll take one on a respirator or a ventilator, and they're really, really that willing. Some people feel that they have been so blessed to have normal children that they feel that they owe the world the responsibility of helping kids that have no one to help them.
The problem is there are not enough foster parents signing up for the job, and this group struggles with the question of how to recruit more. Judy Wattman admits it is a grueling process that cannot be minimized.
It is very difficult to get enough people to be foster parents. It's a very scary process. It's a very lengthy process. And people have to understand that there is a natural family that's involved, that the Department of Human Services and other agencies are trying to rehabilitate, because ultimately the child should be back with his family if they are able to be rehabilitated. So that people have to understand that this process can take a long time and it can be very intense.
Wattman, like Portia Scholl and Linda Carter, believes there are a lot more people in this community as caring as Anita Jackson. Finding them may be difficult, but they'll continue searching. In the meantime, these babies cry and wait in hospitals, which should never be the place anyone calls home.
You the man.
This past summer, almost everybody was talking about Spike Lee, the writer, producer, director, and star of the controversial movie and box office hit, Do the Right Thing. The week the film opened, Spike Lee was chosen as the ABC World News Tonight Person of the Week. He took the hot seat, answering probing questions and challenging critics on Nightline. Then he juggled positive and negative reactions from this Oprah Winfrey audience.
It's a disservice to show us one slice without giving us, you know, the whole picture.
Yeah, but let me ask you that. I'm the first director being asked why there are no drugs in that film.
It was not the first time this filmmaker has been the center of attention. And Lee told Visions, given his own personal agenda, it definitely will not be the last time.
My agenda as a filmmaker was to present the problems, and hopefully by doing this, we could put the spotlight back on race relations, which I feel is a very pressing problem.
Denise James of Action News, reporting for Visions, discovered a Spike Lee who seemed to have as much discontent as some of the characters in his movie. His first target was the Supreme Court of the United States.
The change that we fought for, that people died for, being rolled back, this recent Supreme Court ruling on affirmative action. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if one day say, look, let's take back the Civil Rights Act of 1965, you know, and then go in that direction.
Next, Lee turned to what he sees as the distorted standards and superficial values of teenagers in the black community. He wants this to change.
I think that the first step was to stop these black kids wearing this gold, you know. And you see very little gold anymore. A lot of them wearing these African medallions. Now, of course, a lot of them might not know a lot about Africa, but I'd rather have them wearing those African medallions that cost $4 or $5 instead of doing whatever they did to get the money for that gold around their neck.
Never one to back away from an issue, the Brooklyn native agreed to play a word association game.
Everybody wants to know, whoever know, what the real, the full story, what the partial truth that have come out. I don't believe that she's lying. I really find it hard to believe that she would smear herself with feces, throw herself in a plastic bag, knock herself over her head, and roll down into a ditch. I can't believe that.
Don King.
Don King? You know? Anytime there's a black entrepreneur doing something, I support him.
Do the right thing.
There's an important film.
Spike Lee.
Important filmmaker.
Spike Lee's family.
Important family.
Socks, tube socks, we fight out. We fight out. We fight out.
Visions first introduced you to Spike Lee more than 3 years ago when few people had even heard of him. With She's Gotta Have It, his first big screen triumph, he became an instant celebrity. Then, like now, he welcomed the attention and publicity.
The reason why I made this film is because you rarely do you see black sexuality on screen. I mean, and you don't even see black people kissing on screen. I mean, if I'd have went to Hollywood with this script, or anybody would tell you, if you don't have Eddie Murphy with your prior in your project and trying to get off the ground as a black film, forget it. Black is considered death at the box office.
So you can go on and swear and see if I can good and bad hair.
Don't you wish you had hair like this? Then the boys would give you a kiss. Talk about nothing but bliss. Then you're gonna see what you've missed.
School Days was the next Spike Lee joint. Scenes like this caused some speculation about whether or not Spike Lee was going Hollywood.
Stand it all over your head when you got Sandy's bird. Rather have mine instead.
Well, I'm an independent filmmaker, but at the same time, I definitely acknowledge Hollywood because it is Hollywood, it was Columbia Pictures, and Universal that have financed my past two films, School Days and Do the Right Thing.
Columbia Pictures and Universal may have put up the money for these movies, but Lee had total control over every detail. He says Do the Right Thing is his vision of the way things are. What does he say to those critics who claim this film heightens racial tension and offers no solution to America's race problems?
Well, I think those people are idiots. I mean, I never said I was Jesus Christ. I never said I was a savior. How can they expect me to have an answer for something that people have been grappling with for 400 years since black people were stolen from Africa to come here? I mean, so how am I gonna be criticized on that ground? Well, this film is not worthy because Spike Lee does not have an answer for racism. That's crazy to me.
Do the Right Thing may be the last movie over which Spike Lee has total creative control. This was the second release of a three-picture Hollywood deal, and his next project will have a much bigger budget.
This is going to be a harder fight because the more money my films cost, I mean, they'll leave me alone for $6.5 million, a $20 million budget. They're going to want to have a say, a definite say about who I cast or, you know, those type of creative decisions, I feel, which can make or break a film, and they all want to recoup their investment of $20 million or so, whatever the budget is.
Whatever the budget is, with his track record, it is a sure bet Spike Lee's fans will wait in line with great anticipation to see what's coming after Do the Right Thing.
Always do the right thing.
That's it?
That's it.
I got it. I'm gone.